Well, good afternoon and welcome to this session sponsored by the College of Social Work addressing diversity. My name is Ann Vail and I'm the interim dean of the College of Social Work and really pleased to welcome you here on behalf of my colleagues and our students. You might ask yourself, why is the College of Social Work interested in diversity? Why more than anyone else? Because it certainly is a topic here on our campus today. You know, diversity has always been central to our work in social work. If we look back into our history, we really emerged at a time when this country was experiencing great diversity, and for many of our citizens for the first time. We had an influx of immigrants, we had an influx of people that moved from rural to urban areas, the change from an agrarian society to an industrial society. And we also had the very beginnings of a middle class. And it was in that context that the field of social work emerged and always embraced differences. The field of social work has always looked at differences as an asset rather than a deficit. And so in our practice, we approach people's diversity as one of the first assets on which we can build. But that discussion has continued and has evolved over the years as it has in our society and also as it has here at the University of Kentucky. So we are very pleased to sponsor several activities that promote the discussion and the dialogue around diversity on our campus, but also in our outreach to individuals, families, communities, and society as a whole. So we are very pleased that you have joined us to be part of our dialogue today, and we're very pleased that this can be part of the ongoing dialogue at the University of Kentucky. So today we are also pleased to welcome Provost Tim Tracy here, who would also like to bring greetings, and then we will get on with our speaker. So welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Vail, and welcome everyone. It's great to see the crowd here with us today. You know, the data has shown clearly that, multicultural teams will either perform better or worse than monocultural teams. They've clearly shown those data because, and the differences are that the ones who outperform are because the leader embraces the diversity of opinions and the diversity of experiences of those multicultural teams. And when the leader doesn't embrace that, then they actually underperform monocultural teams. Clearly shows us that there is a huge benefit to embracing our diversity, embracing our differences, but also using that to our advantage to make better decisions and to draw upon that richness of information to develop the best solutions. We want that for our students, we want that for our faculty and staff, all together here at the University of Kentucky. Your commitment today to spend a couple hours with us and Dr. Cleveland, we're very happy to have him with us, is a sign of that, that it's important to us here at the University of Kentucky and it's something that we're deeply committed to. As we said, it's a journey and it's part of our learning process, but I think that the topic today about a culturally competent organizational culture is very timely because, again, it's all of us working together and embracing this and making an important part of what we do every single day in every decision that we make and in every activity that we undertake and action that we take. So I want to thank you again for being here today, for taking this time out. Thank Dr. Cleveland for spending time with us both this morning and this afternoon. And wish you nothing but the best and hope that you will continue to participate in these activities beyond, not only with this College of Social Work, but throughout the university. So thank you again.
Hi, everybody. My name is Dr. Natalie Pope. I'm an assistant professor in the College of Social Work. And I'm going to introduce Dr. Cleveland. His resume is long and he's very accomplished, so I hope you'll bear with me and I think it will be helpful for you to know a little bit about his background. Dr. Cleveland is well known regionally and nationally for his expertise in areas such as diversity and cultural competency, instructional equity, transforming school culture, and conducting culture audits. Dr. Cleveland has provided staff development workshops for a number of school districts and social service agencies, state educational agencies, and universities all across the United States. He's also provided diversity and leadership training for Fortune 500 companies like Ashland Oil and North American Toyota Manufacturing Company. Dr. Cleveland received his bachelor's degree at Morehead State University, his master's degree at Union College, and he completed his doctoral work at the University of Cincinnati. He has worked in the Cincinnati Public Schools with the Cincinnati Youth Collaborative. He was director of the Division of Federal Programs and Instructional Equity at the Kentucky Department of Education. After his tenure at the KDE, Dr. Cleveland taught for 3 years in the College of Education at Morehead State University. In 2008, he joined the faculty at Eastern Kentucky University, where he is currently an associate professor. Dr. Cleveland has received numerous awards and recognitions for his teaching and service. Among these include being named Professor of the Year in 2012 by the Kentucky Association of Blacks in Higher Education. Former Governor Beshear recently appointed Dr. Cleveland to the State School Curriculum Assessment and Accountability Council. In March 2013, Dr. Cleveland received the PG Peoples Award from Fayette County Public Schools for his work in addressing diversity and equity in schools. Dr. Cleveland's commitment and service related to issues of diversity extend to his work in the community. This includes being appointed in 2014 to the Lexington-Fayette County Human Rights Commission. Also in 2014, he was inducted into the Kentucky Civil Rights Hall of Fame. Dr. Cleveland also serves as the Associate Director of the nationally recognized BMW Academy program at the First Baptist Church Bracktown in Lexington. And most recently, in December 2015, former Governor Beshear appointed Dr. Cleveland to the governing board of the Kentucky African American Heritage Center. We are pleased and honored to have Dr. Cleveland with us here today to talk to us about creating a culturally competent organization. So thank you.
Thank you, Natalie, Dean, Dr. Tracy, for inviting me here to the University of Kentucky. I had to get the handheld mic because I cannot stand still behind podiums. I have to move a little bit. And so we want to have a discourse about creating a culture that's responsive to differences. How do you create a culture that values equity and inclusion and diversity and things of that nature? And so here are some things we're going to try to address today. We're going to create an opportunity for self-reflection as it relates to cultural competency. I think the first step to this conversation is looking within. And so we're going to talk about the individual reflection piece first before we get to the organizational piece. And then also examine how beliefs, attitudes, and perceptions impact policies and practices of individuals and organizations. And then also identify strategies for enhancing cultural competency in organizations. I'm not going to address any particular issue that's going on in the city of Lexington, the state of Kentucky, or anything like that. The content I'm going to provide you, you put in whatever context you like, okay? And so that's where we're going to start. At a glance, we're going to talk about implications of culture, cultural competence, cultural competent organization, barriers to a culturally competent organization. We have a number of barriers to why we can't get there. And I want you all, we're going to do a mental assessment of your organization. How many higher education folks do we have in here? Just raise your hand. You're in higher ed. Okay. How many are working in social service agencies of things of nature? Okay. How many are in the health field? How many K-12 folks we have? Anybody from our public schools? Okay. So we have a variety of different people who work in different organizations. And so we want to do an assessment of how well we're doing with culturally competent in your organization. And then steps how we get there, okay? We're not gonna solve all the world's problems in the next hour and 45 minutes, okay? But you are accomplished one thing, one strategy. That's the ministry of presence. You gotta show up, okay? You got to show up. So the fact that you showed up is a start. And then we'll do a self-assessment of where we are. We all have to have a definition of culture, and this is the definition I'm using. There's a number of definitions you could use, but it's an integrated pattern of human behavior that includes thoughts, communications, languages, practices, beliefs, values, customs, courtesies, rituals, manners of interacting, roles, relationships, and expected behaviors of racial, ethnic, religious, or social groups, and ability to transmit and above and succeeding generations. You can include a number of different parts. There's subcultures within cultures. There's no monolithic cultures. And so we understand it's very difficult to stereotype people when there's subgroups within groups. And so this is the working definition. When I talk about culture, that's what I'm talking about. This is really important right here. Culture gives context and meaning. Culture is the filter through which people process their experiences and events of their lives. It influences people's values, actions, expectations of themselves. It impacts people's perceptions and expectations of others. So if people process everything through culture, and I'm going to give out a lot of rhetorical questions, what does that mean to your students, if you're a faculty and your administration? What does that mean to students when you interact with someone else? You have a roommate who's not like you. But particularly when you're developing policies and things of that nature, when you have one group of folks developing all the policy and don't have different perspectives, that could be problematic. Because people function, they make connections to things that they know to things that they don't know, okay? So it's critical that we understand how culture functions, how people learn things through culture. Culture matters, why? When culture is ignored, students are at risk of getting the support they need, or worse yet, receiving assistance that's more harmful than helpful. So if you're not understanding, you don't understand your students, you may think you're being helpful and you're developing policies. I remember when 4th Street Live first came about in Louisville. How many of y'all remember 4th Street Live? And they developed that? So in the initial development of 4th Street Live, there was a policy that said you could not come down there if you had throwback jerseys on, baseball caps, sagging jeans, and things of that nature, okay? Well, that excluded some people from coming down. But they didn't realize that when they developed that policy, that it excluded other folks also, because the hip-hop generation transcends ethnicity and gender. And so it was a lot of people from the East End of Louisville who could not come down there. And so it had an adverse effect on that policy. And the reason why they developed that policy, because the majority of people looked alike and they thought alike, okay? And so they created that policy that was inclusive to exclusive to a lot of people. So you gotta be careful about some of the things you do if you ignore people's culture, because they base everything that they do through their lens of their own culture. What does that mean to recruitment? What does that mean to teaching, okay? That means a lot. The example I used this morning with the College of Social Work, if you process everything through culture and you make meaning through your culture, if you live in Perry County, that's Hazard, Kentucky, and I'm driving through Hazard and I see three children sitting on the fence, and I'll pull over and ask them, if I threw a rock and knocked one of you all off the fence, how many kids are left? And they say two. And I say, that's correct. And then I drive to Louisville. My sister used to live on 18th and Magazine in the West End. And if I drive through the West End of Louisville and I pull up and I see three kids sitting on the fence, and I ask them, if I threw a rock and knocked one of you all off, how many is left? They say none, because we're not going to wait around until somebody comes back around and throw another rock, okay? Because they answer the question through their experience. And so if we teach through our experience, how many students are we excluding in our classes? If we recruit from our perspective, see, the recruiting part is not the tough part, it's the retention is the tough part. So you gotta create a culture on a campus or in your organization where you keep people, okay? It's not the getting them, it's the keeping them. So culture does matter to be effective. So, just yell it out. How is culture like an iceberg? Somebody just tell me, just yell it out. How is culture like an iceberg? You just see the tip. He is correct. Probably about 10%, 5 to 10% of the iceberg, correct? And this is what we usually see when we see people. We may be able to guess their age, their gender, their complexion, some of that stuff, the surface stuff. See, right now it's February. And I'm busy in January and February, you all. And so a lot of schools will have those multicultural days, and they'll tell Appalachian folks to bring quilts, and folks of color bring soul food and all this other stereotypical things, because that's all we know is the tip of the iceberg. But the issues around creating a culturally competent organizational culture, is the deep culture that we cannot see, okay? Sort of like marital status, sexual orientation, funds of knowledge, assumptions, ethnic background, political affiliation, socioeconomic status, you know, discourse pattern, proxemics, and all that is culture bound, okay? For example, let's look at funds of knowledge. Are you familiar with funds of knowledge? Funds of knowledge is what people bring to school or bring to work, is what they learn at home and in their community, and they bring that to the work environment or to school. Let me give you an example. There's a middle school not too far from my house, okay? And it's about 40% Latino in this middle school. And in my subdivision, they're building houses on a regular basis. Now, I can't sell mine, but they're building houses in my subdivision. But anyway, that's beside the point. So on Saturdays and Sunday, on the weekends, I see a number of Latino men doing construction in my subdivision. Is there any math tied to construction? Quite a bit, right? So when I see these Latino men, their sons who attend that middle school is with them doing construction. Well, they will go back to that middle school on Monday morning, not being able to do basic fractions or measurements, even though they've been doing it all weekend, because they don't take in consideration of the funds of knowledge children bring from home and school. And when they come to this university, my university, they go to work, wherever, your social service agency, people bring their funds of knowledge with them. But the only thing is, we don't see that because we tend to address the tip of the iceberg, but the deep culture is where all these issues come from. All the things that's going on right now in our country, a lot of this is because we don't recognize and value the deep culture that people bring with them, okay? You cannot ignore the culture. And here's another way to look at it. This is what you see in your cubicle or your office or your university, but this is what they bring. And if we build policies and practices off this very superficial stuff, and to try to meet the needs of our students and our clients, okay, we're going to struggle. You have to see the whole person, because they tie everything back to culture. So let's look at cultural competence for a second. The difference is, we can all be culturally aware, right? That's just recognizing it, that we have some differences, okay? That's not difficult to realize. There's some differences in this auditorium right now. That's cultural awareness. Cultural knowledge, okay, is just information about different people. Does that require you to do anything? That just means you know, okay? You are aware of it and you know. Cultural competence requires you to do something, okay? It makes you challenging your practices, your policies, your procedures, all those, okay? It looks at your skill sets, and no one had the background knowledge. So you start with awareness and knowledge, but the competency means that you're going to do something different to meet the need of your clientele within an organization. So it requires some action. Here's another way to look at it. Funds of knowledge, information from about individuals and cultural groups are integrated and embedded into policies, standards, skills, service approaches, and techniques. That's what we mean about being, and cultural competence is a journey, okay? It's, you know, not a destination. But how do you take that information about your clientele, whether clients or students or whatever, and integrate that information to develop equitable and inclusive policies? And so if you only have one particular group or one mindset or one perspective developing those policies, someone's going to be excluded, aren't they? Correct? So you have to take that into consideration. And what happens with that, the policy, standards, skills, and service approaches and techniques that match the individual's culture, and increase both the quality and appropriateness of services outcomes. That's what we mean by culturally competent. How do you take this information about your clientele, your students, okay, integrate that and embed it into your policies and practice? How does it become part of your culture of the organization? How does it become part of your DNA of the culture? This is what we do, you know, automatically. So that's the way we're looking at cultural competence. What does it do? Why is it important? When you have a culturally competent organization, you respond to demographic changes in the community. Our demographics are changing drastically. Not changing as fast in some places, but it's still changing. Mark Twain said, when the world ends, I want to be in Kentucky because they're 20 years behind. He really said that about Cincinnati, but since we're in Kentucky. The point is, our demographics are changing, not as fast as others, but it's changing. And what are we doing at our universities? What are we doing in our schools? What are we doing in our social service agencies? What are we doing in our health field to prepare for those demographic changes? Okay, that's the question you have to ask yourself. What are we doing to prepare for that? Improve quality of services and outcomes. Gain a competitive edge in the marketplace. Provide community-focused service delivery. And let's go back to this. Improve quality of services and outcomes. Right now, there's conversations that in the legislation about putting the money back on the outcome, not the income, the input. In other words, you have to make sure students graduate, okay? That they're retained before we give you money. They're having that conversation right now. So it's gonna be based on your outcomes, okay, versus their input. And so we have to actually perform and do well at our universities before we start getting money. I don't know if that's a good idea or not, but a matter of fact, it may be a reality pretty soon, okay? It may be a reality pretty soon. Provide community-focused service delivery and enhance the workplace environment, critical to success. This is one thing I want you to pay attention to real quickly, this piece right here around cultural competency. Being culturally competent means having the capacity to function effectively in another cultural context. Having the capacity to function effectively in another cultural context. What does that mean? When we start producing our students and they start leaving our universities or leaving our K-12 schools or wherever they're leaving from, here's the question you want to ask. How well are your students, staff, faculty, and administration prepared to function in a different cultural context? In other words, you go to a place and the folks don't look like you, don't think like you, don't value the same things. How effective are you in that different cultural context? And we had that conversation this morning in the College of Social Work, okay? I'm in the College of Education, EKU. Are we preparing our teachers? Well, they can teach anywhere in the United States, and not only in the United States, but globally. Global competence. Are we prepared to do that? In a different cultural context. I did a home visit one time in Cincinnati, and I had a colleague with me. And this person was upset because we went to this apartment housing project, and the person we were visiting had the three M's on the wall. Malcolm, Martin, and Marcus. And she was bothered by that because this lady had these three leaders on the wall. Well, you enter in a different cultural context. What she has on her wall is her business, okay? You was there for a different reason, okay? And she couldn't be an effective social worker because she couldn't get past the pictures, okay? That's their cultural frame of reference. That's where they belong, that's peace, and they will struggle with that. So one of the $64,000 questions right here is, how well are the staff, the faculty, and administration prepared, okay, to function in different cultural contexts? And with the changing demographics, the cultural context is shifting. That's part of the issue with all these things going on in the streets of the United States right now. It is perception, and the cultural context is changing, and folks have not been prepared to deal with that. You know, that's a lot of that's behind that, okay? Organizational culture, this is the definition we're using for organizational culture, the basic pattern of shared values and assumptions governing the way employees within an organization think about and act on problems and opportunities. The organizational culture is basically how you do business in that area. What do you value, what do you believe, and things of that nature. Have you created a culture where everybody's included? Culture is the most powerful source of leverage for bringing about about change in a school or any organization for that matter. Let me see a show of hands if you believe that culture is that powerful, organizational culture. Okay, majority of hands. So you all agree that culture is the most powerful source of leverage for bringing about change in a school or organization. I agree with you. If it's that important, how often does your organization assess its culture? How often do you assess the culture and climate of your organization? Okay? And then use that information to inform your policies and your practices. Right? How often do we assess it? We can talk about it, but you have to actually see where we are. What makes an organization culture responsive is determined by how we effectively the organization addresses the dynamics of the culture differences through the five P's. If you want to start transforming the organizational culture, where you are, whether it's a school, university, an agency, wherever it is, a Fortune 500 company, look through the lens of the five P's, perspectives. Okay? Critical. Your policies. Your programs. But you have to look through those five P's if you want to do it systemically. The five P's come into play because of the rapid changes taking place in our society. And these changes are forcing organizations to move away from lethargic, business as usual, reactive mindset. We only do something when something happens. That's a reaction. Okay? We intervene. Okay? We intervene. What kind of culture do we have? You got to ask yourself that question. What kind of culture? Here's the thing I always find interesting is that in your organization, everyone knows the safety plan. Everybody knows that little disclaimer behind all the posters, the EO disclaimer. Okay? We know the safety plan, things of that nature. Why is it that we know the safety plan, but we don't know the diversity plan? What is respected is what's inspected, okay? Because we put the same emphasis on an equity or diversity plan as we do these other plans, we would know that also. But that's just part of the culture, okay? That's just part of the culture. A reactive mindset, status quo, to a proactive one that anticipates and implements change, okay? We anticipate that. This is where the five P's come into play. Perspectives refers to the vision. What is vision? Vision is the bifocal ability to see what lies ahead. Okay? What do we need to be doing the next 5 to 10 years in your organization to prepare for the demographic changes in this state, this city, and this country? The farsight as well as the various impediments in the present, the nearsightedness, and how to avoid them in order to arrive to the future. It also values diversity perspectives when preparing for the future. Who's sitting at the table when we're making decisions about policies and practices? Okay? Who's sitting at the table? It should be representative of your clients or your customers. Right? Because if you're not at the table, you're probably on the menu. Watch when these cuts start coming down from Frankfurt. Who's at the table making decisions? Okay? A sense of vision and mission will lead to appropriate policies, the guarantees that make known the intent of the organization. What policies do you have at your organization that is directly tied to equity, diversity, inclusion, and cultural competence? What policies do we have that? Because that's going to anchor everything else that you do. So if something happens at your workplace, okay, and they say, oh, it's policy. A lot of times it's not policy, it's just practice. Okay? So you say, let me see the policy then. Well, you know, we're still working on it. It's in draft. Well, it's a practice then, if it's not policy. Okay? That anchors your work, the policies, all the other work that you're doing. So you have to make sure that you have strong policies. How many of you all have a policy directly related to diversity, equity, inclusion, and cultural competency? Raise your hand. From your organization, raise your hand if you have a policy directly related to equity, diversity, inclusion, and cultural competency. Let's see your hands. Ooh, that's not a lot of hands. Now, we just said that the mission and vision will lead to approach the guarantees and make known the intent of the organization. Okay? So you got to have a policy in place to support the things you're trying to do. Policies give rise to programs that put into action what equity and inclusion is all about. But effective programs cannot be implemented without the right personnel, get this, reflective of the students, customers, and clients that you serve. The right personnel reflective, okay, of the students, customers, and clients that you serve. And what I hear a lot of times, we can't find diverse applicants. I say, I'll tell you what, give me $1,000 for every person I'll bring in that's qualified, that would be qualified as diverse, okay? Well, they're there, it's cool when you're looking, okay? So we have the personnel needs to be reflective of the students. And here's the other thing. I tell schools this all the time. They say, we can't find any teachers of color. It's hard to find. Now, granted, that's partly true, okay? The number of students who are going to teacher education is not that high. So you got to build a plane as you fly it, okay? You recruit as many students of color as possible, and I mean the teachers, okay? But at the same time, you recruit and you hire people who buy into these concepts and value these concepts, okay? Because the fact of the matter is, you're not gonna have 50% teachers of color in probably very few of our schools, okay? Because they're not there in the pipeline, but you can train and hire them, but at the same time, you hire folks who buy into these concepts of inclusion and equity and diversity and things like that. That makes sense. So you build a plane as you fly it, okay? You don't stop recruiting, but you also recruit folks and you hire people who buy into that. The last one of the five P's is practices. The actual conduct of the faculty, staff, students, administration, and senior leadership, okay? The practices, what you do on a daily basis. Of the five P's, the most important one is practices. An organization and or university may have the best perspectives, policies, programs, and personnel, but these are only cosmetic until practiced or supported, and supported. Okay? We're just practicing. Okay? We have to have those things in place. It has to be done. So even if you have the four P's, okay, the last one's critical. Those things have to be practiced or implemented. Okay? I have a 14-year-old son. I tell him all the time, soap only works when you use it. Okay? So just because we trained you, we got these other four P's in place, if it's not practice, okay, you just got a good plan or a policy and a sheet of paper later and let you write anything on it. I've seen some great plans. Okay? And they're about that thick and the dust is about that thick. Okay? It has to be practice. Okay? And not only practice, but assess to see if that practice is actually working, especially when it comes to infusing equity and diversity into our organizations. It only takes a small number of personnel who in their practice refuse to go along with the program or fail to implement the policy for otherwise well-designed equity and inclusion plan to be sabotaged. I gotta read that again. Y'all didn't hear me, did ya? It only takes a small number of personnel who in their practice refuse to go along with the program or fail to implement policy for otherwise well-designed equity and inclusion plan to be sabotaged. Okay? We cannot assume that everybody's for this. Right? That's an assumption. Okay? But you don't need everybody. Okay? All you need is a small, Margaret Mead taught us that, right? You just need a small group of people to change something really big. How many of y'all know what a trim tab is? How many of y'all been on a cruise before? You ever been on a cruise? I'm in education, so I can't afford a cruise, but how many of y'all been on a cruise? And so this is the typical cruise, Dr. Tracy. You know, you fly down to Florida somewhere, and to maybe Lauderdale or Miami, and you get on the ocean liner, right? And then you go out to the ocean. They drop you off at different islands or whatever, you get back on. Well, about the fourth day, it's time to turn around and head back to Florida, okay? What turns the boat around is a rudder. But the rudder, even though it's a big rudder, the water is so powerful, it's difficult to turn the ship around. So on the big rudder is a smaller rudder called a trim tab. And what the trim tab does is provide leverage for the big rudder to start turning the ship around. So even though everybody in your organization is not with this, you only need a few trim tabbers to get the ship turning around, okay? Everybody is not going to be on board, okay? But at some point in time, they'll get the message, because there's no such thing as your side of the boat is sinking. If the boat's sinking, everybody's gone, okay? But you just need some trim tabbers, okay? Some folks make some noise, but go beyond just making noise, okay? Put forth some action to get things going to turn the culture around. And if you're in a toxic culture where they're not really promoting equity and diversity, okay, or inclusion, and it's a toxic culture, it takes a while, okay, to turn ship around. It takes about 2 to 4 years to change the culture of organization, okay? It's almost like, you know, if you've been doing drugs, you can't go to, you've been doing drugs for 6 years and go to rehab for 6 days, okay? It takes a while to transform the culture around to change the ship, and you need some trim tabbers to do that. But everybody's not going to be on the same page as you are. The five P's have to alter the present organizational structures and cultures. Let me park right there for a second, and what I mean by that. Look at the structures and the cultures of an organization like a computer, okay? The structures is the hardware, okay? The structures like the policies and the procedures and the rules. That's the structures. The cultures is the software. That's the values, the beliefs, and the expectations, okay? And so you need both to transform the culture and the structures of that organization to change the organization. The five P's have to alter the present organizational structures and cultures, especially if these are exclusive and do not benefit everyone in the organizational community. That's students, faculty, staff, administrators, senior leadership, everyone. It has to alter that. And so the question is, well, how do you know if we've done it right or not? Okay? That's the question. How do you know if you're on the right path? Well, here's the answer. If you look around at the decision makers and everyone looks the same, you did it wrong. Okay? Simple as that. You have to have diverse perspectives. And when I say diverse perspective, that means diverse in ethnicity, okay? Diverse in thought, diverse in culture, all those things, okay? All those to make sure you do it correctly. Some strategies, the way to become a culturally competent organization. The organization structures that fosters equity and resource sharing, program development, and administration. Recruit people from different ethnic backgrounds. Provide an ongoing training and education about race and culture issues for clients and staff. Plan cultural and social activities that are culture appropriate and inclusive for all organizational participants. Critical for that. Unless equity and diversity and inclusion are included in the discussions at the highest level of governance, policy, mission, and leadership, change will not occur. Let me read that again, okay? Unless equity and diversity and inclusion are included in discussions at the highest levels of governance, policy, mission, and leadership, change will not occur. People have to know what your mission and vision is, what your purpose is. It's important. And Stephanie, I'm not going to use Walmart this time. I'm going to go with Target, Ann. I'm going to ask you a question. Don't ask me a question when I ask you this question, okay? If you're walking down the street and Target was on fire, how many of y'all rush into that building? Show of hands. Some mean people in this audience. Okay. All right. Target's on fire and there's some people in Target. How many of y'all rush in? Okay, here we go. Target's on fire. There's some people in Target, and some of those people are your relatives. How many would rush in? Dr. Price said it depends on the relative. Here's my point. When I asked the first question, targets on fire, how many rushed in? I think I saw one hand. And then I said, there's some people in Walmart. Half of you all raised your hands. And then I said, some of those people, your relatives, the majority of y'all raised your hands. With leadership, if people don't know your purpose and your vision, they're not going to follow you. And more importantly, people are not going to take a risk without a relationship. As simple as that. And part of that relationship is valuing what they bring to the table. That's all what they bring to the table. Okay? All that they bring to the table. It's critical. So we have to have the discussions at the high level, but they have to move from discussions to action. Okay? We'll talk about a problem for years. You know? We got some of our kids in our schools that are drowning academically, and all we're doing is describing the water. You know, just paralysis, analysis of paralysis, just analyzing the problem, You know, this country just didn't all of a sudden become diverse all of a sudden, like 2 years ago. But how long have we been talking about diversity and equity? A long time, right? Okay? A long time. This is really important. I don't know if you can see this. It matters what leaders do and don't do. The culture of any organization is shaped by the worst behavior the leader is willing to tolerate. The culture of any organization is shaped by the worst behavior the leader is willing to tolerate. Plain and simple. If you go to a restaurant and your food comes out either cold or it's not the way you wanted it, I don't say anything to the waitress or the waiter. Who do I ask for? At the end of the day, the buck stops there. Okay? First of all, the waiter or waitress didn't cook it anyway, did they? They just brought it out. Okay? It's what we will tolerate. It's what we will tolerate. Okay? That's leadership at the top. That's mid-level leadership. Okay? Student leaders. Okay? Starts at leadership. Diversity planning committees should invest less time brainstorming about diversity ideals and more time targeting the sources of resistance to real meaningful organizational change, namely institutional culture. Okay? You got to find a resistance. Okay? You got to find a resistance and where that is. Okay? You know, there's a meme that says something like, you know, you need to be more concerned not with people who suffer from the problem, but the people who, what do you think? Huh? Causing it? Who benefit from the problem. We're always concerned about people, the problem, how it affects those people. Look at the ones that actually benefit from the problem versus the ones that it affect. Okay? You got to find where the resistance is in your organization. Now, here's a question. We're going to start getting to our culture assessment, okay? You're doing a mental assessment. Think about your organization, whether it's a university, a school, a social service agency, a student organization, okay? You know, I go to... I'm in a fraternity, and sometimes I go to meetings and I talk about our organizational culture. I'm like, oh, Cleveland, we won't hear about that. But it's critical because it's what you value, what you believe, what you're about, okay? And that drives your work, right? That drives your work. So assessing your culture is always important. So the question is, in your organization, when it comes to equity and diversity, do you have an accidental culture or an intentional culture, okay? And what is that? In an accidental culture, commitment to equity and inclusion is articulated. Talk about it all day long, okay? But in an intentional culture, the beliefs and the talk is tied to actions and behaviors and results. At the end of the day, it's about results. You ever gone to like a car lot to buy a car? And they see you coming, don't they? You can't even park your car good. Like, good grief, I just got here. So then you go in a haggling mode, back and forth, back and forth. And then this is what they do. They say, well, let me go check with my manager. They go in there, all they're doing is drinking Mountain Dew, smoking a cigarette. They're not talking to their manager, okay? They come back out and say, I'll tell you what, the manager said we can take, you know, $1,000 off. That's all we can do. And you go back and forth. Then finally, after 3 hours, you get tired. You say, you know, I'm out of here. And you leave. The guy, the salesperson, goes back into the office, and he does talk to his manager. The manager says, did you sell that car? And the guy said, I sold it. I sold it. He just didn't buy it. Well, you didn't sell it, okay? So we can talk about equity and inclusion, and we talk about results and things like that, recruitment, retention, and graduation rates and things like that. But at the end of the day, it's about results, okay? Not intentions, but impact, okay? Not intentions, but impact. Accidental culture, we focus on saying. In intentional culture, we focus on doing, okay? Connections are random. Connections are constant and systemic. In an accidental culture, diversity is recognized. In intentional culture, diversity is valued and managed, okay? Compliance, commitment, okay? I was at a university out of state, and we're having something like this, and we had this conversation about what we're gonna do and all these things about diversity and things like that. And so they have an organization like we have in Kentucky, like here in Kentucky we have the Council on Post-Secondary Education. You know, they kind of monitor everything that the universities do, right? I'm sure Dr. Tracy has many meetings with CPE. Well, this university in this other state, they had the same thing. And I simply asked them this. Would you be developing a diversity plan if that entity did not say you had to do it? So if you're addressing equity and diversity and inclusion out of compliance, you're only gonna do so much. But if you do it out of commitment, you'll go beyond what you have to do because you bought into it. Okay? You believe it. So in your organization, think about this for about 15 seconds. Is your organization, does it have a compliant culture when it comes to equity and diversity, or a commitment culture when it comes to equity and diversity? Is your organization about customer service, or is it about customer focus? And there's a difference, okay? Now, Natalie, y'all don't know this, but Natalie Pope, Dr. Pope, she goes to McDonald's every Thursday. Every Thursday when she leaves UK and gets the exact same thing. She says, I want, you know, a number one, Big Mac, Coke fries, but she hates tomatoes. So she goes to the drive-thru, she makes her order. I want a number one, Big Mac fries, no tomatoes. So she goes to the first window, pays her money, okay? Then she goes to the second window and they give her food. Like all of us, Natalie drives by 5 yards, what does she do? She stops and what? Checks her food, right? Opens a bag up, looks at the burger, guess what? Tomatoes. Well, Natalie had a tough day on campus, so she pulls over and parks. She goes to McDonald's with an attitude and says, I come here every Thursday, and you know I hate tomatoes, and you all put tomatoes on my burger. And the manager says, we apologize. You can have the food for free. That's customer service, okay? Customer focus is they would never put the tomatoes on in the first place because of the intentionality. How intentional is your organization about infusing equity and diversity and inclusion in everything that we do? That's called inclusive excellence when you do that. Write that one down and Google it, inclusive excellence. When you infuse equity, diversity, okay, inclusion in everything we do, okay? Everything we do, inclusive excellence. Do we have a compliance culture or a commitment culture? Let's look at it a little bit more. Diversity, equity, and inclusion activities are mandated, okay? Diversity, and equity, and inclusion activities are valued and part of the vision and mission. You know those antiquated diversity trainings, they're mandated. You sit there like for 3 hours for one photo because you don't want to be there. And all they talk about, they do this really antiquated training. This is what African Americans do, this is what Appalachian folks do, this is what Asian folks do. Really antiquated. Because really, trainings like that should be about you, not about other people. Right? It's about you and how you deal with those differences, not the other people. You know? Because when you go, when you approach it that way, you're saying they need to be fixed. And something's wrong with them. Now, we're looking at you and doing some self-examination, what you think about differences, what you think about equity and things of that nature. Diversity and equity goals deteriorates to a wish list. Diversity and equity goals are credible. The focus is on results, not intentions. I used to have I went to Morehead State, and my freshman year, Dr. Pope, I don't know how I got here, really, because my freshman year, I majored in parties and minored in spades. But in that context, I was on the dean's list, okay? But I didn't do really well at all. And so one of the things I did, I went to my history class. I never forget Dr. Jackson, great professor. And so like the first homework assignment we had is like really long. And so I got there and I didn't have my homework. And Dr. Jackson said, Cleveland, where's your homework? I said, Dr. Jackson, I intended to do it, but you know, I just forgot. And he looked at me very sternly and said, boy, the road to hell is paved with good intentions. You get an F, okay? We can always talk about intentions, but it's about results at the end of the day. It's about results. It's about effort. Mission and goals of equity and inclusion are afterthoughts. Mission and goals of equity and inclusion are used as a blueprint for implementation, okay? We use it as a blueprint to do things. Customer service versus customer focus. The difference is intentionality. How intentional are we about this concept, okay? Barriers to creating cultural competency. One of the biggest barriers is our mental models. Our mental models. What is that, our mental models? Mental models are established by past events, experiences, media, and other messages received and serve going forward as filters through which we observe, interpret, and respond to the world. They shape what we see and hear and what we feel and what we do. Mental models give birth to stereotypes. It's our perceptions based on our experiences. The challenge with mental models is that they limit our ways of thinking and behaving. The good news, however, is that they have the potential to evolve through ongoing learning and interaction with new individuals and environments. Becoming aware of our mental models, which is often invisible, is the first step to effectively evolving them and therefore to personal growth. Our mental models, how we perceive things, okay, is based on our experiences. I was sharing with them this morning. How many of you all remember what happened in 2012 and it's directly related to the University of Kentucky? What happened in 2012? University of Kentucky won the national championship, right? And they were in New Orleans. Now, the arena in New Orleans seats about 22,000 people. As typical, we had about 100,000 UK fans down in New Orleans. Took over Bourbon Street, right? So, the game is over, okay? Now it's time for ESPN to interview some UK fans. We had all these smart people from Kentucky. And they chose to interview this guy, okay? He had Kentucky on his shirt. He's had plenty of hurricanes on Bourbon Street, okay? He can't put two sentences together. He has two teeth, one in his mouth, one in his pocket. That's who they interview. So what's the other 49 states' mental models of Kentucky when they see that guy on TV? All the stereotypes, aren't there? All the stereotypes. Now, we know that guy may exist in Kentucky, but that's not the norm. We are very bright people from the state of Kentucky, right? But that guy. And so you put this mental model, okay, and this perception of certain people. And when you see all the things that's going on in our society, particularly in this country, a lot of it is our mental models, how we perceive people. And our mental models act like, they work like a computer almost. I had been going back and forth to Las Vegas last year, went about six times. And my last time I went out there, Imagine I'm going into this room and I'm thinking I'm going to be talking to like 120, 140 principals and teachers and administrators, and I walk in and there's like 200 people clogging. Well, apparently I'm in the wrong room, right? I don't know much about clogging, but my mind works like a computer does a Google search. And wherever it comes, whatever hits I get, that's how I'm going to deal with that situation. Because I don't know much, but, you know, hard shoes and dresses is all I know. So whatever I get from that Google search, that's how I'm going to deal with that situation, which is very inaccurate, okay, for that situation. Same thing happens with you all the time also, okay? When you enter a situation that you're not familiar with, you go back, you hit your rewind and go back to what you know. It may be accurate information, maybe inaccurate information, but whatever it is, that's how you're going to deal with that situation. Okay? And that's what happens. If you grow up thinking that a good number of our African-American males are drug dealers or in crime or whatever, and that's what you see, that's how you approach the situation when that situation comes to you. Okay? Okay? If you think women are too emotional to have senior leadership roles because of your mental models, your perceptions of women, that's how you're going to deal with that situation. Okay? We have to be really mindful, no pun intended, about our mental models. All right, I'm going to show you, I'm going to just prove my point through this illustration. Does everybody have something to write with and to write on? If you do, break it out. I'm going to prove my point. They think I'm crazy, Natalie, but I am, but I'm still going to prove my point. All right. You have something to write with? Something to write on? All right. I'm going to show you a list of words, and you are not allowed to write them down until I say so. All right, you with me? Okay, and you got to do your own work. Okay, you can't help each other. That's called cooperative learning. It used to be called cheating. Now it's called cooperative learning. Okay. I'm going to show you a list of words. You cannot write them down yet. Okay? Everybody ready? All right, here we go. Don't write them down. Now, write down as many as you can remember. I know it's late afternoons. So that's probably a struggle. I know it's for me. Write down as many as you can remember. All right. Stop. Now, all the real smart people in the room who wrote down the word sleep, stand up. Good job. Good job if you wrote down the word sleep. Stand up. Look real close, Dean. Good job, you all, because sleep was not one of the words. Now, we got it on tape, so it's over half the room wrote down the word sleep. Now, I want to just show you that I didn't make it up. That's the original slide, and that's the next slide. Now, why did over half of you all write down the word sleep? Somebody tell me. Because all those words are associated with sleep, right? Before I move on any further, how many of y'all wrote something else down other than sleep that's not on the list? What'd you write down? Alarm? Okay, I can live with that. What else? Yes. Dog? Okay, I can live with that. What else? You wrote down for 10 seconds? You work here? Where do you work? They have mandatory drug testing? What else? Who else wrote something down that's not on there? Who had a hand up? Yes. Peace? Dr. Wilson, we need to talk. Did you write down something that's not on there? Who else? Yes. Lay down? Okay. Stars? Night? Okay. You really wrote Z's, really? Okay, all right. Give me one more. Yes. Room? Okay. Let's go back to the association. Okay? Let's go back to the association. Over half of you all wrote down the word sleep. Sleep was not one of the words, but sleep is associated with all those words on there, right? Let's park right here for a second. What are some other things or other things we add to people's list? So when you're driving through the hollers, that's holler, that's a real word in Eastern Kentucky. When you're driving through the hollers of Eastern Kentucky, what other words do you add to Appalachian folks because of all the stereotypes and perceptions and mental models that you have about them? What else do we add to that list? And when we leave the hollers of Eastern Kentucky and go to the hood, what other stuff do we add to people that doesn't belong there, but we add to it because of our mental models? We have to really be really cognizant about adding stuff to people's list that don't belong there based on our perceptions. That makes sense? Okay? Look at that. Half of you all wrote down the word sleep. And here's the other thing. When you start feeling that pressure that you got to finish, you go to what you know, don't you? How many of y'all went to that? You was trying to figure, you had like 8 words, and the last word you wrote down was sleep because you was feeling the pressure. And when you go into situations like that, you know, that's unfamiliar to you, you're going to go to what you know. You're going to go where you're comfortable. Watch this. See what kind of reaction I get out of you all versus the College of Social Work. Now, I'm going to set the situation up, okay? Don't ask me any questions. You're in rural Kansas. It's 5 below 0. The wind is blowing in a circular motion. I'm making this up, meteorologist, okay? The wind's blowing in a circular motion. Your car breaks down, okay? A mile this way is a house, a family of white people, and a mile this way is a house of African Americans. Both of their phones work, okay? No one doesn't have AT&T, but doesn't have Sprint, okay? Both their phones work. Which house are you going to? Same distance, the walk is the same. A mile's a mile, wind's blowing like this. Both phones work, and you know both families. You don't have the answer if you choose. Now, I'm going to the African American home, okay? That don't make me a bad person. People just flow to where they're comfortable, that's all. That don't make you a bad person. So if you're white and you say, I'm going to the white house, what, you racist? No, you're going to where you're comfortable. That don't make you a bad person, don't make you racist. You just do that. Now, anybody want to tell me where they're going? Yes, ma'am. She done turned into a CSI show. Okay. Okay. Without the TV influence, you would go there. Somebody else tell me where they go. Yes. A house? Why? Because you think a tornado? Okay. Where else? Where else would you go? Somebody else tell me. Oh, yeah. You can't heal it if you conceal it. It's okay. The house with what? We don't know all that, you all. All we know is what we know. Y'all a bad crowd to deal with, okay? All we know is what we know. Wind's blowing like this, a mile that way, both phones work. Most of us are gonna go where we're comfortable. Now, I don't know which one you're comfortable with, because I don't know you all, but you're gonna go where you're mostly comfortable, right? And there's nothing wrong with that. So I'm not saying that you need to get out of your comfort zone. What I'm saying is you need to stretch your comfort zone. Just stretch it, okay? Just stretch it. Half of you all wrote down the word sleep. There's a whole lot of people in jail because of you eyewitnesses, okay? And see how our mental minds work? Because if I think, they always show him on TV, or somebody looks like him that's a criminal, and then I see a crime, and I see that maybe they look similar to him. Oh, it was him. Because that's what I have in my mind. Okay? Our mental models are that powerful. Okay? At least half of the exercise I get every day comes from jumping to conclusions. Okay? Making assumptions and things of that nature. What are some other barriers to creating a culturally competent organizational culture? We already talked about mental models. The isms, racism, classism, sexism, ageism, ableism, all these isms. Okay? If they exist out there, they exist in your organization. Right? Most places, whether this university or my university or this school or that agency, those are just microcosms of larger society. So whatever's going on in larger society, they exist in all these different organizations. And we have to acknowledge that. Okay? We have to acknowledge that. My mother used to say, when you mention racism in a crowded room, it gets so quiet you can hear a rat pee on cotton. Okay? Because nobody wants to talk about racism. It exists. You can't heal it if you conceal it. Okay? The first step was addressing it was the ministry of presence by showing up. You did that. The second part is admit that we have issues and we have to address them. Okay? But we have to address all these issues around privilege and things of that nature and all the isms. The lack of knowledge base. That's where training and things like that, and one day training is not going to remove this issue. It's a process about becoming a culturally competent organizational culture. It's a process, but getting the information starts. At least recognizing that, it helps. The lack of committed resources, human and financial, okay? Now, we're gonna take some serious budget cuts in higher education. I guarantee you, when it comes to any kind of diversity initiatives, I promise you, we're one of the ones to get hit first. Because we approached a lot of times through a compliance culture, not a commitment culture. Because you're really committed, you'll do your best to try to protect it. All right? We're going to make some serious cuts in the next 18 months. But using any initiative around diversity, equity, those are the first ones that get cut. Lack of leadership commitment. It has to come from leadership. Leadership has to sell the why, not the what and the how. That's from a guy named Simon Sinek. Okay? If you want an initiative, okay, to take off, don't sell how to do it or what it is. You sell why you need to do it. Okay? Sell the why. And he talks about in his TED talk that when you're trying to move an initiative, that you sell the why first. And he compares Apple to other companies who sold all these different phones and gadgets and things of that nature. And he said the reason why Apple was so far ahead of everybody at first because Dell and other companies tried to sell the what. You need to buy this product and this is how you use it. And Simon Sinek said, no, what Apple did was they sold the why first. Why you need it. Why you need that cell phone you never put down. Once I tell some 19-year-olds, sell the why, I can sell the why you need some Jordans, why you need an iPhone. I don't have to tell them how to use it. They'll figure that out themselves. I don't have to tell them what it is. You sell the why first. So when King was going to the D.C. on the March on Washington, he sold the why first. That's why 250,000 people showed up in D.C. Okay? He didn't give, I have a plan speech. He said, I have a dream speech. Right? And people bought into the why, not the how and the what. Organizations have to get committed to issues around equity and diversity. And they got to understand why they're doing it. Okay? We can teach them how and the what, but it's the why you're doing it. The why will get you committed, okay? The how and what will get you compliant. We want committed folks, okay? We want committed folks. Lack of training opportunities, okay? And that may go away with the budget issues. And staff resistance. We don't want to do it. Why do we have to do it, okay? All that is part of our barriers through creating a culturally responsive culture. Now, here's your last assessment. I want you to rate your organization. I'm going to give you four stages. Stage four is the ideal place you want to be as an organization as it relates to cultural competency. Okay? Stage four is where you want to be. Here's the first stage, and I hope no one's at this stage. The organization is culturally blind, is insensitive to cultural differences, equity, and inclusion issues. It is the least desired stage in that services provided do not meet the needs of diverse populations in the organization. I hope in 2016 we don't have anybody at stage one. But hope is not a strategy. Okay? Stage two. The organization is aware of cultural differences, equity, and inclusion. At this stage, the organization or system recognizes the need to address cultural diversity, equity, and inclusion issues, but generally does not know what to do or how to do it. Services provided minimally meet the needs of diverse populations. Okay? We know we have some issues, we have some differences, but we don't really know what to do. Okay? We really don't know what to do. Then you have stage three. The organization accepts and values diversity, equity, and inclusion, and sees the need for cultural competence. At this stage, the organization is aware and has a systemic plan to meet the needs of diverse populations and assess this plan on a regular basis. So now we know we got a problem. Now we got a plan. Well, when we said about plans, right? They lay there and let you write anything on it. But the plan is assessed, and it's a living document, which means you can change that plan anytime, middle of the year, whatever, and assess to see if it actually works. Then we have stage four. Intrinsically aware, okay? It makes us move to action. The organization has a systemic plan that addresses diversity, equity, inclusion, and cultural competency that is implemented and assessed regularly. Human and financial resources are readily available to support the plan. This plan is championed by senior leadership. Stop right there. It is championed by senior leadership, okay? We can talk about it all day long, but your audio needs to match your video, okay? You can't just talk about it, you have to be about it. This process occurs automatically and almost intuitively. Services provided meet the needs of diverse populations with little conscious effort. So, we're not even going to stage one. There's stage two. We are aware, but not yet competent what to do about those issues. And then three, we are aware of it and we develop the plan, okay? And make sure when you develop that plan that you have diverse perspectives and diverse thoughts at the table developing that plan. And then we have stage four. Well, we added resources to it, it's assessed on a regular basis, and senior leadership is actually supporting it. Not through compliance, but through commitment. And the senior leadership, they sell the why we need to do it. Okay? They sell the why. Now it's time for courage and transparency. Okay? The camera's facing me, so you won't even be on camera, okay? It'll be okay. Anybody want to tell me what stage you think their organization's in? Two? Okay. No written plan? Okay. Fail to plan, plan to fail, right? Anyone else? Come on, y'all. I won't get you fired, I promise. Yes. Action. Mm-hmm. Okay. That's correct. There is actually a competency stage, okay? Anyone else? Yes? A two and a three? Okay. All right. This is a quick snapshot of things that can be done, but it goes to another step about action and measuring that action and assessing action and proving. Let's see where we are. The consequences of having things always the same, okay? Always the same, status quo. Ignoring cultural issues costs time, money, and efficiency, okay? Some of the consequences can include unhealthy tensions between, we have any of those in the United States? Unhealthy tensions between people of differing gender, race, nonstop. You can't even turn CNN on. Nothing but tension. And part of that tension comes from our perceptions of how we see people who do not look like and think like us. Okay? So even though the organization is critical, it starts with the individual people. Okay? It starts with the individual people. Loss of productivity because of increased conflict. Okay? Inability to attract and retain talented people of all kinds. And nothing but EEO complaints. And see, these micro issues, are you familiar with microaggressions? Microaggressions meaning small. Simplest thing is that we're in a meeting and she says something and everybody ignores it. Then I say the exact same thing. Oh, great idea, Roger. Where'd that come from? Okay? Or I walk through the hallways only speaking to certain people and I'm in a leadership role. That's really small, isn't it? But it builds up to larger things and then becomes a complaint. Okay? Then it becomes a lawsuit. Okay? So all these things, keeping the status quo, it can happen like that. Ensuring cultural competence at the organizational level. Staff development, okay? Addressing attitudes, the skills, and things of that nature. Organizational infrastructure. Organizational resources required to deliver, facilitate delivery of cultural competence services. The resources have to be there. And the services and interventions, the degree in which organizations deliver services in a cultural competent manner. Ways to get there. And then you have to have effective planning. And I think when I show you these steps, one is already taking place in most of our organizations. Get their attention is phase one. Create a sense of urgency. I think in most places we already have a sense of urgency. Okay? Depending on who you ask. Okay? And sometimes the sense of urgency comes out of nowhere. Connect to the mission and vision. Okay? Put meaning to it. Right there is where you sell the why. You sell the why right there. Put some meaning to it. Don't tell anybody how to do it, okay? Don't tell anybody what it is. Just sell why it's important. Sell the why, okay? And then you have ongoing job-embedded training, okay? Don't just train people, but train it directly to what they do every day in work, okay? So it's relevant, okay? Just don't be training to be training them. Make sure it's job embedded. Walk the talk. Okay? Implementation and results. And then how do you sustain it? How do you build enough capacity and sustainability? So if somebody hits the lottery and moves to Hawaii, it's still going. Okay? You got to have sustainability. Effective planning. And then next steps in your organization. What do you do? First of all, get started. Okay? Do something. Get started. Shift your thinking. Focus on diversity, equity, and cultural competence and inclusion with systemic approach. Consider the needs of tomorrow. Define goals. Movement is not progress, and progress is not excellence. Identify the components in your system that are functioning well now and start there. What are you doing really well in your organization as it relates to equity and diversity and cultural competence and inclusion? What are you doing really well? Whoever that is, start there. Replicate some of those steps if you can. Have courageous conversations about the issues. As I said again, you can't heal it if you conceal it. Okay? We have to have courageous conversations. Identify and examine your barriers. Okay? What are some things in place that are keeping you from getting there? Okay. Now it's your turn. I need you to do me a favor. How many of y'all have smartphones? Silly question one. All right, turn your phone on. And hit camera. Now, like you're gonna take a picture of someone else, hit the opposite so it's facing you. Okay, now look at yourself. Just do it for about 30 seconds. Now you're ready to do your selfie, okay? I didn't say make a call or call them, but I just, it's always one, isn't it? Okay, you're good. Now, you put your phones down, you got a good look at yourself, right? Okay, that's where it starts, that individual person. Now we're going to do a selfie. Based on what I shared with you today and what you already know, okay, this is your own action plan. Based on what we need to do to get a culturally competent organizational culture, what will you continue doing in your organization as an individual? What will you continue doing based on what I shared? What will you continue doing? What will you continue doing? What will you stop doing based on what you've heard? What will you stop doing? What will you continue doing? The second one is, what will you stop doing? What will you start doing based on what you heard? So what will you continue doing? What will you stop doing? And what will you start doing? Okay, I need some folks to share out what they will continue doing based on this conversation, which is one-dimensional for the most part. Continue doing based on what you heard in your organization. I get a volunteer, please. What will you continue doing? Anyone? Continue listening? Okay, thank you. What will you stop doing? Assuming? Okay. And what will you start doing? What will you start doing based on this conversation? What will you start doing? Don't overwhelm me without response. Okay. Okay. And I have some cards and I'll pass out to you all. I'm going to send you information. You were saying? Okay. All right. Anyone else? Sell the why. Sell the why. Yeah. Get folks to commit. Okay. Yes, sir. Research that why I didn't sell it. Mm-hmm. Anyone else? Figure out the why. Okay. And a lot of times, some people know the why and some don't. Okay. There's not a lot of new stuff under the sun. Not a lot of new stuff. I just want to talk about this real quickly, about perceptions and expectations. I need two volunteers. or voluntodes. Thank you, sir. Come on up. You're on the stage. Anyone else? Come on down. While they're coming up, I want to talk about getting back to perceptions and mental models and how they impact expectations. And I'll see this happening particularly first generation students in universities and students of color in universities. But it doesn't happen when they get to college necessarily. It happens before they get there. Come on over, my folks. Okay, what's your name?
Megan.
Megan, you stand right there so the light face them. Your name, sir?
Benny.
You know I know Benny? Because Benny was over at EKU with me. All right, then we have Megan and Benny. Let me show you how this works in a K-12 situation, okay? My perceptions, my expectations of students. I have two fourth grade students, okay? We have Megan and Benny. I'm the teacher, okay? And we've been talking about social studies, civics, and government. And they've been writing essays about the current presidential administration. But let me introduce you to my students first, okay? First, we have 9-year-old Megan, okay? Megan sits in the front of the classroom, okay? She comes to school dressed really nice. She's engaged, her parents are engaged. Her mother's on the city council. Her father's on the school council here in Lexington, okay? Just a good student. How you doing, Megan? Great, okay. Then we have Benny. My man, Benny. Benny sits in the back of the classroom, okay? He comes to school with tattered clothes, even smells sometimes, okay? He's in the fourth grade. We haven't seen his parents since kindergarten, okay? Now, enough about the two students. And so I'm teaching. We're talking about the current presidential administration. And it's getting late. It's like 1:45, 1:50 in the afternoon. I see I'm losing my students. So I call two students up. It's what we call for checking for understanding. I've been lecturing for 25 minutes. Let me see if they're getting it or not. So I bring these two students up. And I ask them a simple question. I said, Benny, who is the Vice President of the United States? And he says, my good grief, boy. You should know that by now. You've written an essay, and by the way, your essay is horrible. You need to work on it. You should know that by now. Anyway. Hi, Megan. How are you doing, Megan?
Fine.
Doing okay? Megan, who is the Vice President of the United States? Megan says, you can do this, young lady. You're a very smart young lady. Who is the Vice President of the United States? She says, I know you know this, Megan, because your essay is great. She says, Joe, that's right, Megan. Joe Biden. Okay? Now, one at a time, raise your hand and tell me what this teacher did with these two students. One at a time, just tell me one thing. Anyone? Yes, one thing. Okay, I helped the one I felt was competent. Take a step that way, Megan. Take a step that way. I said one, girl, get back here. It's hard to get good help. What else? Just miss. I made an assumption. Okay, Benny, take a step that way. Take a step that way, Megan. Small one. Now you're funny, okay. Somebody else said, huh? I encouraged one. Take a step that way, Megan. Did I encourage this one? This guy? Take a step that way, Benny. Somebody else said something over here. I rejected a stereotype about who? Both? I just assume, you know. Take a step that way, Megan. Take a step that way, Benny. What else happened? Practice my mental model. Okay. In a stereotypical way. Take a step that way. Take a step that way. What else happened? And that's one thing equity is all about, is access. Okay? Exactly. Take a step that way. Take a step that way. What else happened? Who received more time to answer the question? That's in teacher education, we call that wait time. Okay? Take a step that way, Megan.
And when you provide wait time, you're implying that the information is in that student. So I gave her more prompts, more cues to answer, right? I didn't give him prompts and cues, did I? Take a step that way, Benny. Watch the podium. Okay? Because the Latin word for education is educere, which means to lead or pull out. It's in both of them. I just believe it's in her versus him. What else happened? Anything else happened? Yes. Exactly. I embarrassed him. Take a step that way. Exactly. As some of our co-eds would say, I put him on blast, didn't I? All right? What else happened? I confirmed expectations. Take a step that way. Anything else? I made a personal connection with her. Shook her hand, asked her about her parents. Benny, whatever. Take a step that way, Benny. Give me one more. Who said that? Exactly. And not only inferior, but get very specific. Academically. Because there's this thing called academic self-esteem and social self-esteem. In other words, he may be fine when he's not in school. He feels great about himself. But because of his interactions and his experiences in school, he has a low academic self-esteem and making him feel inferior. Take a step that way, Megan. Now, there's this thing called academic disparities. In the universities, it could be graduation rates, ACT scores. In our K-12 schools, it's based on basically our K-PREP, which is our state assessment. And academic disparities is basically a comparison of an assessment with different groups, okay? And that is called an achievement gap. Look at our achievement gap. That has nothing to do with ability, but had to do with based on my mental models and my perceptions of these two students. And see, the other thing is, we're going to start recruiting Benny for college, and Benny's not going to show up. You know why? Because if he gets another teacher like me in the eighth grade, he's going to drop out mentally. And regardless of what the law says in Kentucky now, to 18, he's still going to drop out physically. We're going to have to go looking for him to bring him back into school. The dropout rate is not a high school issue. A dropout rate is a preschool through high school issue. And then when you get to here, this universe or somewhere else, you never see them because what a fourth grade teacher did to that student based on my perceptions and my mental models and had nothing to do with these two students' ability. That's how strong our mental models and perceptions are. We create this opportunity gap, really, because if you don't achieve in school, you're going to have less opportunities, right, later in life because of my perceptions and our mental models. All right, give Megan and Benny a hand. I was fine with UK until he just told me that. I said, what are you doing up here? He said, I'll go to UK now. Y'all stole him from EKU. He's a UK student. Treat him well. And you handle your business, too. I'll come over and find you if you're not handling your business. And you know I will, too. All right, you all, let's wrap this up. But I do want to, and I do like, who said calculate the why? I like that. Go see Simon Sinek's TED Talk on YouTube. Okay, it's really good about leadership and selling the why. Last words to ponder. When we feel a sense of belonging, it is not because we are the same as everyone else, but because we have been accepted as we are. Okay? Don't ask anyone to drop who they are at the threshold of the door in any of your organizations or any of your offices or anywhere else. Okay? Let them be who they are. All right, and this is my moment of clarity. I check for understanding. Can I get about three people to finish that first sentence? Based on our conversation, finish that sentence. I learned that. I got somebody to finish that sentence for me. I learned that. You have to sell the why. Yep. Okay, all right. I learned that. Anyone else? I learned that. The five P's. If you want to get it to a systemic level, build the five P's. I realized that. Anybody having an epiphany or aha moment? I realized that. I realized when I walked into College of Social Work this morning that I ran into a cousin I haven't seen in, I don't know when, because she never came home from Seattle. I was like, I didn't know she was in Lexington. We ran into each other. We got to talk a little bit. I had an epiphany. I realized that. I realized that. People are not going to take a risk without a relationship. I realized that. How culture is like an iceberg? We only see the tip. We have to be brave enough to go below the surface, right? I was pleased that. Excuse me, your organization's on track? Good. All right, y'all talk to her. Okay. It's about replication, right? I was pleased that. All right. She was pleased that she came today. Okay. I was not aware of that. Is anything you're not aware of today? I was aware that. I was not aware that Benny transferred to UK. Dr. Pope, it's your responsibility to stay on him. What are you majoring in? Civil education? Okay. I got any education folks in? Anybody from College of Ed? Ooh, I'm going to talk about you all. Okay. Yes, sir.
I'm aware now that I'm failing phase five. I've had plans. I've done recruitment. Mm-hmm. I've had diversity. And yet I haven't gotten to get along with
them. Okay.
And we're having a struggle with the differences.
Okay. And here's the thing about that. You know, one, you can't do it by yourself. That's for sure. But if you get to stage four, okay, you know, that's doing well in most places I've been, you know, even though we want to push and go to the next level. So, you know, you still keep pushing, right? You still keep pushing. But also, the key thing is also get the right people around you also that's doing want to do the same thing. That's critical. Anything else on here that you want to respond to? Maya Cleveland, what do you think? I'll call my daughter out. You got to answer one of these things. Don't give her a thumbs up. What did you learn? I'm paying all this money to the UK. I want to know what you learned. All right, good. All right. Anything else for the good of the order? Trim tab. Yeah, you may not get everybody initially. It may just take a small group of folks to start. But if you get the right folks, you get the momentum going. Okay? Yes, sir. The key thing is you also got to know your audience also. You got to know your audience. And so even though you're doing all the work at the ground level as students, but you got to know the folks who are making the policy also and get voice with the right audience. Okay? And so that's critical also. But you still don't stop trying, though. Okay? This is tough work. It's called committed work. But like I said, the key strategy from day one is the ministry of presence. You show up. You know, that's the first that's showing up right there. All right. I want to just thank Stephanie and Dr. Pope for inviting me and the dean. I had a good time at UK today. Don't steal any more of our students at EKU. And thank you all for having me. Thank you.